Hello everybody, my name is Claire Dross and I work at Edacor, a company providing open source tools for the IDA language. In my team, we develop a tool for formal verification of a subset of IDA named Spark. One of the major restrictions imposed by the subset is the absence of aliasing. It simplifies verification notably, as the tool can safely compute data that can be affected by each instruction. Because of this restriction, pointers have been excluded from the Spark subset from the beginning as a major source of aliasing. Some support for pointers has been added in the recent versions of Spark using an ownership policy inspired by Rust in order to prevent aliasing. In this talk, I will present this support and try to give you a feeling of what kind of algorithms are supported in Spark currently for pointer-based data structure and how they can be verified. This presentation will be separated in 6 parts. First, I will do a quick review of the IDA and Spark languages. Then I will explain how we have added support into the Spark subset and which restrictions we have chosen to support pointer types in Spark. Then I will go to recursive data structures, which are implemented using pointers in IDA, and I will explain what about them is supported in Spark. Afterward, we'll go to algorithms on these recursive data structures, and in particular, we'll try to understand how we can traverse them using a loop in an iterative way. This can be done using borrowing of ownership, we'll see. Afterward, we'll explain how this borrowing is supported in proof through what we call predicted value. And finally, we'll explain how we can annotate this loop doing traversal of recursive data structures using a new kind of annotation named pledges. So first, a quick overview of the IDA and Spark languages. IDA is a general purpose language. It is rather old. Its first release was in 83. It has a Pascal-like syntax where declarations are separated from instructions. If you want to declare something inside a list of instructions, you need to use a declare block, which is an instruction. You have one here. It has a part before the begin which consists of declarations. Here we declare a value y, and then you have instructions after the begin which are in the scope of y. After the end, y goes out of scope. IDA is strongly typed. You can declare new types that you can name. This type can have additional constraints. For example, here we have a type small int, which is an integer type. It ranges from minus 100 to 100. I can then declare a subtype of small int called small nat, which additional range constraint, ranging from 0 to 100. IDA also supports natively arrays. We have an example here. The type small int r ranges over integers from 1 to 10 and contains value of type small int. This type and these constraints are associated with checks, which are mandated by the language. For example, if I store a value in a variable of type small nat, I have a range check, which makes sure that the variable is indeed in the range of the type's constraint. If I access a value inside an array, I will have an index check to make sure that the index is indeed in the bounds of the array. These checks can be performed at compile time by the compiler, if everything is statically known. Otherwise, the compiler will introduce code so that these checks are performed dynamically at runtime. In this case, if the check fails, there will be an exception which will be raised. It is also possible to do contract-based programming in IDA. You can write contracts, in particular on subprograms. Some programs in IDA are either functions or procedures. Functions will return a result, procedure work by side effect. Here we have an example, we have a procedure increment, which parameter x of type integer. This parameter has mode inout, which means that I can modify it in the body of increment. I can put a contract on this program. It is made of two Boolean expressions, a precondition and a postcondition. The precondition says that I can only call increment on the value x, which is strictly smaller than the last integer. It is normal, if I want to increment an integer, it should not be the last integer. then I have a post condition saying that after the execution of increment, the new value of x will be bigger than the value of x at the beginning of increment. This value is written x tick old. Tick old here is called an attribute in Ada. It is also possible to put contracts on type. There are weak and strong type invariants. Strong type invariants must always hold. Weak type invariants must only hold on the boundary of the enclosing package enclosing the type. So here we have an example. We have type sorted R, which contains only arrays which are sorted in ascending order. So the predicate on it is a strong type invariant, which must always hold. It states that for all values in the index range of the array, save for the last, the value must be smaller than the value at the next index, so sorted. These contracts are associated with checks, but only if the code is compiled with assertions enabled. In this case, there would be an exception if one of the contracts fails at runtime. The idea behind Park is to formally verify, statically verify, all these checks which are normally performed dynamically. So the idea is to verify runtime errors like range checks or index checks that we have seen before, and also all the contracts. So if I declare a value of type sorted R, I will have a check to make sure that the array is indeed sorted, and this will be verified by Spark statically without running the tool. In the same way, if I call increment, I will have a check to make sure that the precondition will necessarily hold. So Spark performs static verification, which means that the program is not run. Everything is done by an analysis prior to running the program. It uses what is called deductive verification. It is a method which takes Spark code annotated with contracts, run post condition in particular, and then it translates that as a set of mathematical formulas. These mathematical formulas are then handed to automatic SMT solver, which will decide if they are valid or not. If all the formulas are valid, then it means that the Spark code and the contracts were correct. Spark is a sound tool in the sense that if it can prove a program, then the program is correct. But it is not a complete tool, which means that if it cannot prove a program, it doesn't mean that the program necessarily has a bug. Generally, these kind of tools are either sound or complete because of the undecidability of the underlying logic. Now let's speak about pointers. As I have said before, pointers have been forbidden in Spark since the beginning, because in particular they were introducing aliasing between different data structures, but also because they have a wide range of specific errors associated to them, for example double free or dangling memory or things like that. The fact that pointers were not allowed in Spark was not that big a deal as one might think, in particular if we are used to C, developing in C, because in Ada, pointers are less necessary than in C. In particular, arrays are natively supported, so you don't need pointers to do arrays. And also, as you have seen, there are parameter modes which can be used to say that some parameters can be modified by the subprogram, so you don't need a pointer to have a reference to, for example, an integer. Still, pointers are useful in Ada for specific things, in particular to define recursive data structures. And this is what we will be talking about later in this presentation. So first, let us look at what pointers look like in Ada. In Ada, pointers are called access types. We can define an access type as is done in the slide. The type int access is defined to be an access type designated integer. If I want to dereference an object of this type, I will use the notation .all. So for example here, I have an assertion stating that the value referenced by x is 10. In Ada, you can allocate memory on the heap using the new keyword. You will give the value that you are using to initialize the data cell Instead, what is called a qualified expression, which is an expression which gives the type and the value that you see here. And since Ada doesn't have a garbage collector, you need to deallocate the memory manually if you want to avoid memory leaks. To support pointers in Spark, we want to support them in a safe way, so we have introduced some restrictions on them. So there are two of them. The first one is that we only support designated data which is allocated on the heap, so not the stack, not globally. In Ada, there are two kinds of pointers. The first kind is named pool specific access type, the type int access that we have seen before. This is pool specific access type. And then the other type, which is generalized access type, as a keyword all, this one is allowed to designate value everywhere, in particular on the stack. For example, if here I have a variable of type integer name y, I can get a pointer to this variable using the tick access notation. Both the declaration of types of generalized access type and the tick access attributes are not allowed in Spark. You can only designate values which are allocated on the heap. This has some advantages. In particular, it avoids the problem of dangling references when some variables on the stack get out of scope. It also avoids the question of whether the variable, the object, is allocated on the stack or on the heap when you want to deallocate it. And also, it avoids the possibility of aliasing between an object declared on the stack and a pointer. The other restriction that we impose in Spark is an ownership model, which is used to avoid aliasing between values defined on the heap. So let's see a bit more about that. The idea is that when you compile a pointer, when you do an assignment with a pointer, you will create, in fact, an alias. So for example, if I have a value x designating the value 1, then I do an assignment of x into y, then x and y are aliased of the same value. So if I modify, for example, y, the value designated by y, then I also modify silently the value designated by x. So we don't want that. To avoid that, we have a notion of ownership, which is associated to a pointer. If the pointer has ownership of the value it designates, you can modify it. If it doesn't, you cannot. And the ownership is moved from a pointer to the other on assignment. So for example, if I have the pointer x, which designates the value 1, when I initialize it, it has the ownership to the value it designates. Then I assign x into y, and I move the ownership. It is transferred from x to y. So afterward, y has the ownership of the cell. So I can read it and modify it through y. But it is not allowed anymore to read it or modify it through x. In practice, it means that it is still possible to have aliases in a Spark program, but you will not be able to see them because you cannot no longer read x after you have moved the ownership to y. So if you modify something through y, you will not be able to see that the value which is designated by x is also modified. Thanks to these restrictions, we can support access types in proof in a relatively simple way. We can simply ignore all the aliases. We say that all structures having pointers are in fact normal structures with no alias, they are distinct. And then the only thing that we have to worry about is whether they are null or not. So in fact, they are handled a bit like what we call in functional languages option types or maybe types. We say that a pointer, either it is null, or if it is not null, it has a value and we know the value. So for example here, we have a pointer x which designates the value 10, so we know that it is not null, and when we do the dereference, we can check that it is not a dereference of the null pointer. Note that this translation is only valid because of the ownership rule that we have seen before. Indeed, if I have x and y which are aliases of each other and I modify the value through y, then if I was able to assert that the value designated by x was 10, I would be able to prove that because, as I said before, We do not consider the aliases for the analysis. We consider that there are no aliases. All the data structures are independent or standalone. So fortunately, this is not allowed by the ownership rule, which is why we can use such a simple encoding. So now let us go to recursive data structures. In AIDA, it is necessary to use a pointer type, an access type, to construct a recursive data type. The idea is that first you declare the type without giving any definition. So it is called an incomplete declaration. For example, here I have an incomplete declaration of the type list cell. This incomplete declaration, I cannot do much with a type declared like that. I cannot, for example, put it as a parameter of a function or something like that. But I can still create an access type to this type. So here I can create the access type list, which designates value of type list cell. Then I can create a completion of the type list cell. And in this completion, I can use the type list, doing the recursivity. So here, list cell has a field data, which is an integer, and a field next, which is the rest of the list. Of course, it is possible to create more complicated recursive data type by interleaving mutually recursive definitions. For example, I could put in the middle here an array type which contains value of type list, and then I could have an array tree, for example. In Spark, there are no specific restrictions regarding which data structure, which recursive data type you are declaring. All recursive data types are okay in Spark. But if you want to construct the structure in Spark, then you are restricted by the ownership policy. As we said, we do not support aliases in Spark, so we will not be able to support data structures which have six cycles in them. So this means that simply linked lists and trees are okay, but doubly linked lists or DAGs are not. Now let us go to algorithms over these data structures. Most algorithms over a recursive data structure will involve a traversal. In general, it involves a traversal. There are two ways to traverse a recursive data structure. We can do this either iteratively using a loop or recursively with recursive calls. If we design the algorithm in a recursive way, the ownership is not causing any trouble. For example, here I have two functions which are defined in a recursive way. The function length will compute the number of elements in a list in a recursive way. If the list is null, then it returns zero, and otherwise it returns one plus the length of the rest of the list. The function int_th is similar. It takes a position I as a positive integer and a list x, and it returns the data field of the element of as position I in x. So if I is 1, it will return x.data, and otherwise it will search for the element at position I minus 1 in x.next. So these two definitions are perfectly acceptable in Spark, and the tool can be used, for example, to check that the precondition of nth, setting that I must be smaller than the length of x, is enough to make sure that inside the body of nth we never dereference the null pointer. As AIDA is an imperative language, we would also like to be able to traverse a recursive data structure using a loop. Unfortunately, this is a bit more complicated with ownership. So here I have an example of a procedure set all to zero, which takes as a parameter list x, and which sets all of its elements to zero. This procedure uses a loop which sets all the data field of each element to zero. So let's look at what happens with the ownership policy of Spark. When we create the value y, which is used to traverse the list, we will transfer the ownership of the list designated by x to y. Then, when we inside the loop, we do y is y.next, we go to the next element of the list, the ownership of the first cell of y is completely lost. Indeed, it is not accessible through y anymore, and it's not accessible through x either, since x doesn't have the ownership. In fact, you will have an error here if you run the Spark tool, because it will say that there is a memory leak. The memory of the first cell is lost. Then when you reach the end of set all to zero, then you will not be able to restore the ownership to X, since you don't have it anymore. So, how can we support this kind of algorithm? What we need here, in fact, is a way to transfer the ownership of the list X to the value Y, but only for the duration of the subprogram, then we want it to return automatically to X. This notion exists in Rust, it is called borrowing, and in Spark we have borrowed the notion from Rust. We can, in Spark, say that an object that we declare is not a new structure but only a borrower of the structure. It is not a move, it is a borrow. For that, we must use a type which is named an anonymous access type. So it means that it is not a named access type like the type list that we have before. It is an anonymous access type, so it has no name. It is just access list cell. If we use such a type, it means that the ownership is just transferred temporarily from X to Y for the scope of Y. So inside the scope of Y, so here inside the begin part of the declare block that we have here, the ownership is transferred to Y, so it is a bit like if X was moved into Y, you are able to access and modify the data structure through Y, but you are not allowed to either access it or modify it through X anymore. But when we reach the end of the declare block, then Y goes out of scope and automatically the ownership returns to X. So we can again access and modify the data structure through X. It is exactly what we want for our loop that we have seen before. When you have a borrower, it is possible to modify it so that it designates another part of the data structure that it used to designate, a deeper part. So for example here, I have, like before, a borrower Y which borrows the ownership of a list X. When I do Y, the data is zero, I will modify not the handle Y, but the underlying data structure X. When I do Y is Y.next.next, here I don't modify the underlying structure X, I modify the handle, the borrower itself, so that it borrows something deeper in the data structure. This is called a reborrow. Using reborrows, it is possible to modify our procedure set all to zero so that it is valid Spark. For that, I only need to modify the type of Y so that it is an anonymous access type. Then I know that the ownership of X will be transferred to Y, but only temporarily for the scope of Y, which is the body of set all to zero. Inside the loop, when I do y.data is zero, I will modify the underlying structure. And like before, when I do y is y.next, I will do what we call a reborrow, so I will change the handle so that it designates something deeper in X. When I reach the end of set all to zero, the ownership returns automatically to X, which is what I want here. So thanks to this notion of borrowing, it is possible in Spark to do simple traversal of recursive data structures. More complex traversals, in particular involving a stack, are not possible in Spark because of the anti-aliasing rules. Now, we have seen that to be able to traverse data structure using a loop, we have introduced a notion of borrower, which in fact are basically aliases, which can be used to modify a data structure arbitrarily deeply and at a place which is not statically known because of reborrows. So, how do we support that in proof when we have said that we don't support aliases in proof? So, we have said before, in proof, we don't consider pointer to be anything special, we don't consider possible aliases between different data structures. So, when we encounter the declaration of Y, we will create a standalone data structure which has no particular link to the data structure X except that they have the same value at the point where we do the borrow. Then, when I am inside the scope of Y, I can modify this standalone value without a problem. So first, Y is modified to only designate the last cell of the list, and then this cell is updated to designate the value 0. When I am in the scope of this this borrower, the fact that I modify X when I modify Y is not really a problem because I don't see it like before because of the ownership rule. I don't see it, so I don't really care that when I modified Y dot data, I was also modifying X. But when I go, I reach the end of the scope of Y. Here I have a problem because now I am allowed to access X again. So I need to know what this value is, and I know that this value might have been modified during the borrow. So the question is, what do I do? The idea is that along with this standalone value for the borrower, we will also create additional value, which stand for the value of the borrower and the borrowed object, but not now, the value that they will have at the end of the borrow. Those are called predicted values. Of course, when we create this object at the time of the borrow, we don't know the value that they will have at the end of the borrow. But it's not a problem because we are doing a formal analysis and not execution or compilation. So we don't need to know the value to say that they exist. So we only say that we have two objects, y at end and x at end here, and that we don't know anything about their values, except that they are equal. Because since we know that X and Y are in fact aliases, we necessarily know that at the end of the borrow, X and Y will have the same value. When we reach the end of the borrow, we use these values, these predicted values, to reconstruct the value of X after the end of the borrow. The idea is that when you reach the end of the borrow, you will know the new value of Y at the end of the borrow. For example, here, in our small example, I have set y.data to 0. So I know that at the end of the borrow, the value of y is 0, then 2, then 3. Since I also know, thanks to our relation that we have written about the value of y and x at the end of the borrow, that x is equal to y at the end of the borrow. So I know that x at the end of the borrow is 0 and 2 and 3. This is a bit more complicated when we do reborrows. So here I have the example that I had before, where I have the value y, which is a borrower of x, and then I do reborrow, saying that y is y.next.next, and then I update the data field of y to 0. So here, when I do y is y.next.next, when I do the reborrow, I will update the value of the standalone object for y, so that it designates only the value 3, like before. But I also need to update the relation between the value of x at the end of the borrow and the value of y at the end of the borrow. Because of the reborrow, the value of y at the end of the borrow will not be the value of the structure that was designated by y at the beginning of the borrow. It is a value now which is only the third element of the list. So now I know that the value of the end of the borrow will of x will be two elements, and then the value of y at the end of the borrow. What's more, I know the exact value of these two elements that are at the beginning of x. Indeed, these elements are what we call frozen by the borrow. This means that they cannot no longer be updated during the scope of y. Indeed, they cannot be updated through y, since y doesn't have access to them anymore, and they cannot be updated through x, since x doesn't have ownership for the direction of the borrow. So we know that at the end of the borrow, x will be a structure starting by the value 1 and then the value 2, and then values that are in the value of y at the end of the borrow. So following the same reasoning as before, I can update the current value of y but when I encounter the value y.data is 0, and then when I reach the end of the borrow with the value of y at the end of the borrow that I have computed and the information, the relations that I had before, I can deduce that x is a list with value 1, 2, and 0. And so I can prove the assertion saying that x.next.next.data is 0 at the end of the borrow. So we have seen that we can support pointers in Spark, basically by avoiding aliasing using an ownership policy. We have seen that data structures defined in AIDA through pointers are supported in Spark too, to support traversal using a loop on this structure. We have introduced the notion of borrowers, which are basically aliases. We have seen how they can be handled for the proof. Now we will speak about how we can annotate the programs which are using this kind of technique, which are using borrowers, like our program set all to zero that we have seen before. First, let's justify why we need annotations at all. The small programs that we have seen until now are proved without any kind of additional annotation for the tool. However, here we want to verify algorithms which are traversing a recursive data structure using a loop. And who says loops and deductive verification says loop invariance. For those who are not familiar with deductive verification, it is a process which works by traversing the control flow graph, and constructing a set of logical formula which are equivalent to the state of the program on a step-by-step way. So, of course, if you are traversing the control flow graph and constructing something on a step-by-step way, you will have a trouble when you encounter a cycle in the control flow graph. The solution that is usually used by deductive verification tool is to add the user to provide additional information through a loop invariant. This loop invariant should summarize the information that is known in the loop. It is used as a constraint by the tool to flatten the control flow graph and so that to have only acyclic passes in the program. Writing the loop invariant is generally considered cumbersome by users, but unfortunately, generating them automatically is still a research topic. So we need to the user will need to supply the invariant, and it needs to supply it in a careful way, because as in this invariant is used as a code point, if you are not precise enough in what you say, you will not be able to prove much about your program. Basically, you must describe everything which has been done by the previous iterations of your loop. So here I have an example. It is a procedure name also set all to zero, but it is simplified with respect to the previous one because X here is not a list, it's simply an array. So the loop, which is going over the array X, is just a for loop over the element, over the indexes of the array, which go from 1 to 10. I have put an invariant in this loop. It says that in the previous iterations of the loop, I have set the value to 0. So it has a universally quantified formula which says that all elements of the array up until the element at position I are equal to 0. Now let's go back to our more complex example with the list. I have a loop, so I need to put an invariant. What do I want to write in my invariant? I want to say that, well, basically, I have a certain number of zeros, as many as I have had loop iteration until now, and afterward, I have something which is an alias of the value y. Well, this is not something that I will be able to say normally in a loop invariant, because I am not allowed to speak about the value of x inside the scope of its borrower y. So I need some kind of special annotation to be able to describe something like that. A researcher team at TH Jurek, who are working on the verification of Rust program using the Prosty tool, have come up with a notion of pledges, which are specific annotations exactly for this kind of case. The idea is that these annotations are used to speak about the value of the borrowed object during the borrow, but not the current value of the borrowed object, since this one, we cannot speak about it, the value of the borrowed object at the end of the borrow. And since we need to relate this value with the value of the borrower at the end of the borrow, we are also allowed to speak about the value of the borrower at the end of the borrow in these special annotations. In Spark, we don't have special annotations, We just call pledge standard assertion or standard loop invariant or standard contract, which speaks about the value of a borrowed object or a borrower at the end of the borrow. This can be done by a special function called atAndBorrow function, like this atAnd function that we use here. In this example, we have, like before, a borrower Y, which borrows the ownership of a list X. And we say in an assertion that the value of X at the end, the data field of the value of X at the end, will be equal to the data field of the value of Y at the end of the borrow. This is true no matter what happens in the scope of the borrower, since X and Y are in fact aliases. Now, let us look at what we can prove about these pledges. When we prove something about pledges, we never do a look ahead to know what will happen later in the program, even if the pledges are speaking about values at the end of the scope of the borrow. This means that we will prove things about value at the end of the borrow, but only based on what we know already for sure now, where we are in the subprogram about these values. So here is an example. I have a list, the same as before, with value 1, 2, and 3. Then I do a borrow of this list x into y, and then I do a reborrow, saying that now y is x.next.next. At this point, I can say in a pledge that the value of s.data at the end will be y, and the value of x.next.data will be 2. This is provable, because indeed we know at this point, since we y only designate y.next.next, that the value of x.data and x.next.data will necessarily be the values that they have at this point, which is 1 and 2. In the next assertion, I say that the value of x.next.next.data will be equal to the value of y.data at the end of the borrow. This is true too, because x.next.next.data is an alias of y.data. In the last assertion, I say that x.next.next.data is 3. At this point, it is true, but we don't know if it will still be the case at the end of the borrow, because since y still has access to this cell, to x.next.next.data, it is still possible that I will modify it in the rest of the borrow. So this cannot be proved. And this cannot be proved no matter what happens afterward in the program, since I don't do any look ahead. I can only prove here something which I already know about the value at the end of the borrow. You will note that this closely resembles our notion of predicted values that we use for proof. So in fact, to prove pledges, we simply translate them as annotation on the predicted value. So here, for example, if I represent my predicted value like before, I see that I can prove that the value at end of x.data will be 1, the value at end of x.next.data will be 2, and that I will not be able to prove that the value of at end of x.next.next.data is 3. Since I don't know its value at this point. Using this notion of pledges, I want to now prove my set all to zero procedure. Please don't look at the loop invariant right now, we will go over them together. So what do I want to state in my invariant? I know that I want to speak about the value of x, which is borrowed, and to be able to do that, I need to use the pledges that we have just seen. These pledges allow to speak about the value of x, but not now. They can be used to speak about the value of x, but at the end of the borrow. And to be able to prove it, we must only put in there some information that we already have about the value at the end of the borrow. So what do we want to say? Well, at a given iteration in the loop, what do we know about the value at the end of the borrow? We know that what we have already modified and frozen, which is that x will have as many zeros as there will have been iterations until now. Because at each iteration, we add a zero which is frozen. And then afterward, it is an alias of y. This is what is written in the small picture. So to state that, we will first introduce a global variable to count the number of iterations that we have already done. It's named c. This variable we say that it is ghost because it is only used inside annotations. When we mark a variable as ghost in Spark, the compiler will know that when the compilation is done without assertions, then it can remove completely the variable from the code. So this variable is first initialized to zero, and then in each iteration it is incremented. The first loop invariant is a regular loop invariant. It speaks about the value of C. It says that C is the number of elements which have already been traversed. So it says that it is the length of the list Y at the beginning of the loop, which is accessed through the tick loop entry attribute, similar to tick old, minus the length of the list Y now, to the number of elements that you have already seen. Then the rest of the loop invariants are the pledges. They describe the picture which is at the bottom of the slide. The first one states that the length of X at the end of the borrow will be C plus the length of Y at the end of the borrow. The second speaks about the elements using NTH. It says that for elements which are before C, the value of X at this position will be 0. And for positions which are after C, the value will be the corresponding value in Y, which is exactly what is written in the picture. Thanks to these invariants, we are able to prove this program, and in particular, to prove what we would like to prove on such a procedure, which is that the list X at the end of the call will have the same length as the list X at the beginning, and that all its elements will be equal to zero. So, to conclude, we have seen that pointers are now supported in the most recent releases of Spark. They are supporting using an ownership policy, which is used to enforce absence of aliases. Thanks to this support, we can in particular implement recursive data structures in Spark, as long as they do not have cycles. If we want to do traversal on this structure, we can do recursive traversals, but if we want to do traversals using a loop, we need the notion of borrowing, which allows to only temporarily transfer the ownership of a data structure to a borrower. This borrowing, which is basically a kind of alias, are supported in Spark through predicted values, which are the value of the borrower and the borrowed object, but at the end of the borrow. Then, to be able to verify this procedure used to traverse recursive data structures, we need to handle loops, and so to provide loop invariants. So we have introduced a notion of pledges, which are annotations for borrows. Thanks to all that, we can now verify programs in Spark involving recursive data structures. As examples, I have, for example, verified the insertion into a binary search tree in Spark in an imperative way. I could also implement an insertion in a red-black tree, which is balanced. But for this one, I had to use a recursive algorithm because an imperative one, an iterative one, will need a parent field to be able to go up, back up in the data structure, and the parent field means a cycle, so it is not Spark friendly. If you are interested, you may look at the blog posts that have been written on the subject that you can find on the IDACORE blog. You can also look at an article that we have published recently at the CAV conference. It is the implementation of the support of pledges and borrowers is a bit different because it was an old implementation. This one is the newest one. If you are interested in Ada and Spark, you can get some courses on the Learn website of IDACORE. You can also download the Spark toolset in a free way on the IDACORE website. And since Spark is an open source tool, you can check out its sources on the GitHub repository. Thanks for your attention. Hello? I don't know if you can hear me. Hello, everybody. Is it working? Ah, yes, I can hear you. So I don't know if there are questions or... So there are several questions. The first one is about positive assertions and negative assertions. I'm not sure I understand it completely. If it is a question about decidability and what is verified by Spark, the question, when you verify a program using Spark, if Spark verifies the program, then you are sure that it is correct, which means that all the defects which are detected by Spark, like runtime exceptions and failures of assertions and contracts, you are sure that they will not occur. What you are not sure is if the tool doesn't verify the program, it says that there is a defect which can occur, you are not sure that it can indeed occur. Possibly you are either just missing some annotations, some contracts, or maybe just the solvers are not strong enough, it is too complex for them to verify. So if your program is verified, you know that it is okay. If you are still not verified, you are not sure that you have a bug. There is then a question about memory leaks. The Spark uses the ownership model to track, to prevent aliasing, and so we can also use it to detect memory leaks. So indeed we do it. So if you run Spark on your program, it will tell you if you have a memory leak. But it is not used, the analysis done by Spark is not used by the compiler to deallocate automatically values which are not void. The analysis of Spark is independent from what is done in the compiler. Currently, there are no ownership pointers in Ada, in the Ada language. If some are added at some point, then probably there will be a notion of automatic deallocation when value go out of scope. There is another question about anonymous access type as program parameters. So this is handled by Spark. This is if the access is mutable, it will be a borrow. If the access is a constant, then it will be what we call an observe. So it is allowed to have multiple observers as opposed to only one borrower at a single time. So it is supported. So the next question is about the possibility to use an anonymous access type to only read and not modify the underlying data structure. Yes, it is possible. It is called an observe. When you do that, you are still allowed to refer to the underlying structure which was observed, but only to read it, not to update it. And you can have multiple observers for the same data structure. When all observers go out of scope, then the ownership returns completely to the initial data structure and you can modify it again. Then there is a question about how fast is a proof and borrow checking. The borrow checking is fast, no problem. This one is an easy analysis
which is not done through provers, which means also that it's a little bit dumb if there is nothing which is value dependent in the borrow checking. But it is fast. For the proofs, they go through provers, so sometimes they take a lot of time. Sometimes you will reach a timeout and not be able to prove something which is true, but because it is too long. So you will have to help the prover to add assertions, to cut your functions into other functions. It's a bit like what you do normally for proofs in deductive verification. Nothing special about pointers. I don't know if you have other questions. Otherwise, either everything was perfectly clear or I've lost everybody. Oh. There is no, well, the question is, what is the difference of semantic between anonymous access type and named access type? So there is no real need for this difference of semantic. In fact, it is rather that we use the different notation which are in AIDA to represent different concepts in Spark. We needed a notion in Spark of borrower as opposed to a move. So we used the already existing notion of anonymous access type to represent a borrow or an observe. It has some advantages. In particular, it is possible to convert from a name access type to an anonymous access type, but not the other way around, which is what we want. When we have something which is a borrower, we don't want to be able to reassign it into something else. So it was rather that different types existed in AIDA, and it was practical to reuse them for different notions for proof. But possibly at some point, we may encounter an issue with this handling, and then we would change and add an annotation, maybe with an attribute or an aspect, to say that a type is some object is a borrower instead of a standalone object. Another question, it is still possible to have storage errors. Spark doesn't verify storage error at all. It doesn't verify it for the stack, so it doesn't verify the absence of stack overflow, and it's the same with the heap. It doesn't verify that you still have memory in the heap when you allocate. It's something which should be verified by other means. Another question, will storage pools be supported in Spark? For now, we have no plan to support them. I suppose it could be done, at least for some usage, if we had interest from people. Usually, we have two reasons to add new things in Spark. Either we think ourselves that it would be a good idea and it would make the language easier to use, or we have some users, either paying customer or not paying customer, asking for the announcement. Here we have not had anybody asking for the announcement, and we have not found the interest ourselves. So for now, it is not planned. Is it possible to store a borrow in another data structure? The answer is no. You cannot do that. You can just use them on the stack. And last question, Spark only does subprogram by subprogram analysis. It doesn't do whole program analysis. It means that you have to add contracts to all your subprograms to verify them. Don't hesitate to tell me if some answer is not complete for a question.